you are in the journey of faith, in the spiritual life, this is a place where you can come and see what we're up to and hopefully get a taste of what God is up to in our midst. And we hope that you experience a taste of heaven, a taste of love, a taste of community. Even though we're online, we are one and we are connected. And we just want you to know that we're so very happy to have you with us in worship today. So if you are new here, I want to invite you to go online. The website is there on your screen under Connect and fill out some information for us. This is not so that we can send your email to all the world and collect money for spam people. No, no, that's not what we do. This is just so that we can get to know you a little bit better. And if you sign up for our weekly email newsletter, you'll know what's going on every week. And if you do that, we'll also donate $5 to Dawn to Dawn Action on Homelessness. We always choose a partner charity for the year here at St. George's United Church because we believe that what we do as a community of faith should also have an impact on the wider neighborhood around us. And so we want to put our money where our mouth is, so to speak. And this is a charity that is very close to all of our hearts. And so if you sign up for that email newsletter, we'll make sure that $5 goes in the pot that goes to them. Now, also, if we head on to the next slide there, you'll see that we have lots going on every week at St. George's United Church. Every Monday at 11, we have Bible study. Right now, we're working on how to read the Bible, and so you can join with Reverend Ryan for that study. We also have a midweek prayer service. That's Wednesdays at 12:30. You can join us on Zoom here or on Facebook Live. And that's where folks from our community hold up song and prayer for not only those in our midst, but those all around us and around the world, holding everyone up in prayer. And then Thursdays, one of my favorite days, 6 o'clock, it's where we climb into the blanket fort or tent or whatever you've got. You don't even need a fort, but I tell you, it is more fun with a fort. And we gather together. Unlike this day, we can all see each other's faces and we can interact and we share together in a story, in a song, and we join together holding up prayers before we all scooch off to bed at night. Now, I think that also Kara has an announcement for us today.
Yes, I do. And so today we are just hosting a informational session, a town hall, if you will, after worship today. Just a conversation about where we're going in the summer since we are heading into the summer months. I mean, it was Pentecost last week and now it's Trinity Sunday. And then we're just going to be into July. So just to give you a full scope of what's going on and how we're stepping into reopening stages, which there's a lot of planning ahead of us, but we do have good people behind it. And if you can stay with us after service, that would be great, but we will be posting the information afterwards as well, since it is a sunny day and it's not January weather so far. So I understand if you have to go, but just stay on after service, stay on with us after the postlude, and see what's gonna happen over the summer.
Okay, I think that that's all we've got in terms of announcements at this point. I've been having some connectivity problems, so if you see me disappear, don't worry. We'll have the sermon text. We'll have everything. We'll have people reading it in my stead if we have trouble. But in the meantime, now that I'm here and we're here together, please join me in the call to worship for today, Trinity Sunday. Holy Trinity, one God in three persons.
We behold in the splendor of creation your majesty and our responsibility.
O Holy Trinity, one God in three persons.
We behold in the face of Jesus Christ your divinity and our humanity.
O Holy Trinity, one God in three persons.
We behold in the spirit of truth your glory and our calling, bound to you forever. We will ever praise your name.
Let us pray. O God, we honor this day the majesty and the mystery of your name. You are both infinite and intimate, known and unknowable, transcendent and transparent. In love, you have made us as your own and invite us to join in your divine dance. We will never rest until we rest in you, blessed Trinity, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us join our hearts in the call to confession. Creation displays the glory of God, but our sin keeps us from rejoicing in the love God reveals. Yet Christ Jesus, the Son, carried our sins to the cross, and the Holy Spirit breathes new life into us so that we may praise God, our Maker, Savior, and life-giving lover. Let us confess our sins that we might receive such grace. Presence, life, fire, God who is three in one, we confess that we have turned away from you. We gaze upon ourselves as if we are worthy of worship. We take your creation into our hands not to love, but to use and then discard. We go to the people of the land not to serve, but to press them into our service. We do not deserve that you would even notice us, but we pray for mercy because you are merciful. Flame of love, purify us from sin. Eternal now, lead us to your truth. Risen One, baptize us into union with you. Transform us into faithful disciples who worship you alone, God who is Trinity. Amen. Join me in the response. Compassionate One, hear our prayer. Stretch out your hand and healing love. Create in us a clean heart, O God, and renew your spirit within us. Hear this good news. The Holy One of Israel, the Redeemer of all the world, and the Holy Spirit who comes as the breath of new life, forgets the sins of all who repent. I declare to you, therefore, that you are forgiven. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Mother of us all. Amen.
Revive us again. May each soul be rekindled with fire from above. Hallelujah, thy glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thy glory. Revive us again. Hallelujah, thy glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thy glory. Revive us again.
Do you know that I have been singing that song all week? I love that song. I'm walking through the forest, walking down the street, doing my work. Hallelujah, I'm the glory. I could just go all day with that. So welcome, friends, welcome. Gather around and let's see what's in the treasure chest this week. So, first of all, we have our white linen. And I have this white and gold stole on. Last week, we used red for the Holy Spirit coming at Pentecost, the special birthday of the church. Does anyone remember what the white cloths and linens are for? Yeah, that's right. I know I heard it out there somewhere. Special or holy days at church, we use white and gold for that. But wait, Easter's over. It's not Christmas yet. What could be special about today? Well, today is the Sunday we call Trinity Sunday. Now, listen, Trinity is spelled T-R-I-N-I-T-Y. And those first three letters, T-R-I, tell us something. And that something is three. So think of the word triangle. Three sides, right? Triangle, T-R-I. Now think of the word tricycle. Three wheels, right? T-R-I. Try. Okay, Ingrid, now all we want to do is go outside and play. So what does this have to do with church? Well, we know that God is one, but God is also three. Three and one? Yeah. Let's talk about that for a minute, okay? Oh, that's so exciting. I get excited about the Trinity. Last week, we celebrated one part of God, the Holy Spirit, right? That's the part of God that lives within us, remember, and teaches us how to live. It lives within everybody in the world. It gives us life and reminds us to do what is good and right and just and kind. And at Easter, we celebrated the part of God that is Jesus, God's Son, who was raised from the dead. Jesus is the part of God that came to earth to make sure everyone knew how much God loves them and to teach everyone to follow in God's way. Now, in a few minutes, Heather is going to read from the Bible, from the very beginning of the Bible. And that story is about when God created the earth and everything on it. It's a story about God who created everything and continues to create today. She'll start by telling us that so long ago, Before there was anything, there was just this big soupy darkness. And God breathed. God blew over that darkness. And if you were at Fort Fellowship, remember that funky word, that Hebrew word that we practiced? Ruach. Can you say it? Ruach. God's breath. So God blew God's breath, ruach, over the soupy darkness. And then God made light and earth and water and all the plants on the land. And so when you look outside and see all that God has created, you can be reminded of God. We sometimes call God Father, and Mother works too, kind of like Mother Earth, showing us all about God. Now remember, God is three in one. Mother, Father of us all, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. And each of these three things teach us about the way that God is. Jesus taught using stories, and he also stood up for people who weren't being treated fairly. The Holy Spirit fills our hearts with God's love. And in creation, in nature, we can learn even more about God. So let's see what else is in my treasure chest. Ah, fruit, because God made those too. Wonder how fruit can help us learn about God. Let's see, what have I got here? Maybe I'll need to scooch in a little bit closer to make sure everyone can see. I've got a banana. I brought this one for my friend Ellen. Now, this is one banana, right? But check this out. If I open it up and I take a bite, let me get the peel going here. That is a delicious banana. I know that God wants all of us to be fed and happy. But check this out. I'm going to get even closer to show you this cool thing. I can separate this one banana into three separate parts. Did you know that bananas can split like that? Three separate parts. They're all still banana, but together, they make the whole thing. Huh. So what else have I got in here? Ooh, I've got an apple. What can an apple teach us about God? Well, let's see. I also have in here a little cutting board, a little knife. So I'm just going to cut this apple in half. You can't see it, but I am being very safe. And if you take a look at this apple up close, you can see that it's one apple, but we have the core, the flesh, and the skin. All apple, but together they make it whole. I wonder what else is in my treasure chest today. What could it be? A mango. What can a mango teach us about God? Maybe life with God is sweet, like a mango? God is beautiful and bright? What if I open it up? What happens then? Oh, God moves in ways I wouldn't expect. God drips and slips in all sorts of unexpected ways. Now, you know what we have here again? The skin, the flesh, and look, right in here, this hairy bit is the pit. Wow, three in one again. I am really trying to drive this point home about God. We have these three important parts of God that all together, each one is God, but all together make up God. And it is confusing and hard to understand, but somehow wonderful and mysteriously true. And so when we talk about God, we talk about God who made us and mangoes and trees, and God who loved us so much, God had to come and be with us in the person of Jesus, and God who doesn't leave us alone, but lives inside of us as the Holy Spirit. So God is three and is one, and it's confusing, and I love it. So God made you and God made me, and you know what, when we're all together like this, we are the church. Because the church is not a building. The church is not a steeple. The church is not a resting place. The church is a people. And man, that just really feels like a song. Maybe Carol can help us sing it.
I can, Ingrid, but all this talk of God and fruit is making me really hungry. And it's just a good thing we're all worshiping at home right now, because you can grab a snack and you can still stay for the town hall after service instead of running out of the church building for lunch. So yes, let's sing.
I am the church, you are the church, we are the church together. All who follow Jesus all around the world, yes, we're the church together. The church is not a building, the church is not a steeple, the church is not a resting place, the church is a people. I am the church, you are the church, we are the church together. All who follow Jesus all around the world, yes, we're the church together. We're loving from a distance, connecting in new ways, and though right now we're scattered, the Spirit's working in us.
Everybody!
I am the church, you are the church, we are the church together. All who follow Jesus all around the world, yes, we're the church together. Yes, we're the church together.
Today's reading is from the book of Genesis, chapter 1, beginning at verse 1. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be done a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome that separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome, and it was so. God called the dome sky, and there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees of every kind on earth that bear fruit with a seed in it." And so it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seeds of every kind, and trees of every kind bearing fruit with a seed in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years, and let them be lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth." And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the dome of the sky. So God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves, of every kind, with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters in the sea, and let the birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening,
and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things and wild animals of the earth of every kind. And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every kind, and everything that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make humankind in our own image, according to our likeness, and let them have domination over the fish of the seas, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female. Female, he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. God said, see, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw everything that he had made, and he indeed it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. And on the seventh day, God finished the work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it, God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. O God, whose first creative word set universes into place, who stretched across the whirling void infinities of time and space, O speak to our chaotic day a word of ordered grace, we pray. Amen. So today we're beginning a short little sermon series, Back to Basics, on a few select texts from the book of Genesis, the first book in the Bible. These scripture texts bring us back to basics because they not only take us back to some of the most fundamental biblical stories, they also take us to the root of some of Christianity's basic truths, some of its basic convictions. The first comes from today's scripture passage, Genesis chapter 1, the first book, the first book of the Bible. The creation of the universe, the creation of humanity. And the text I want to focus on comes 26 verses in. Then God said, reads the verse, then God said, let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness. Today's basic conviction, when we're going back to basics, is that human beings are made in the image and likeness of God. Made in the image and likeness of God. According to the Bible, we humans possess a characteristic not shared by the rest of the natural world. Now, clearly, it doesn't mean that we look like God. After all, God is spirit. God doesn't have a nose or knees or leaves or anything like that. But instead, it means that human beings have a uniqueness, a something else, a something more that reflects our Creator. Some interpreters believe that this something more is referring to our role in and among the natural world. Ancient Near Eastern cultures understood kings as representatives of a particular god on earth. The kings would rule on that god's behalf. This view is a about the role of humanity among creation. We're made of God to govern creation on God's behalf. And there are some sort of historical issues on about that that I'm not going to get into quite right here, maybe for another sermon. Other interpreters, though, see the image of God as something more as referring to some capacity that we have that other creatures don't have. It could be the power to shape our environment. The great 5th century theologian St. Augustine thought the image of God referred to the human mind, the threefold structure of memory, understanding, and will as evidence of the Holy Trinity. There's a little Trinity reference for you, in case you're missing that. In any case, in this view, the image of God means that there's something about human nature that reflects our divine source. We are like God in some way. The most important interpretation for us today, however, may be a third one. The third view is that the image of God in humanity has less to do with what we're supposed to do or what we are, and it has more to do with our value as human beings, with our worth as children of a common creator. As I said earlier, the scripture passage reflects its Near East origins. Kings were believed to be the representatives of particular gods on earth and given the role to govern on behalf of that god. And this passage reflects that view in some ways. But if you notice, if you pay attention to the details, if you do a close reading of the text, radical notion into human history. Because here it's not just the king. It's not just a particular person, a particular group, a tribe or nation that's been chosen to represent the divine on earth. It's all of humanity. Humankind is made in God's image. Now, most cultures and societies have believed and continue to believe that the family we're born into, closer to the divine we are, the more worthy and worthwhile we are. But in the biblical view, coming in the first chapter, the image of the Creator is not only to be found in the well-born, the royal, the wealthy, the powerful, or successful. But it's found in humanity as a whole. The great Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann puts it like this: there is one way God is imaged in the world, and only one, he says, in humanness. In humanness. All humanity bears the image and likeness of God, meaning that when we look into the face of another person, we're not amino acids or a fellow mammal, although all of the above are true. Instead, we're in it looking into the face of our Creator. Which also means that when we're good to another human being made in the image of God, we're not just hurting another creature. We're actually doing violence to God himself. We're desecrating God's very image. Now, considering the news lately, I think the implications for this basic truth of Christian faith are obvious. Christians aren't opposed to racism and for correcting systemic injustice just because we're hopping on the latest progressive cause or political bandwagon. It's because we believe that God is not only the creator of all, but God has created each and every human being in God's own image. God's own likeness, whether male or female, black, white, brown, Asian, indigenous, rich, poor, gay, straight, or every other category, every other letter in the ever-growing acronym. But it goes slightly beyond that even. And maybe this is the most stunning, infuriating part of being made in the image of God. It also goes beyond, far beyond this or that identity. Jesus says that God sends the rain on the just and the unjust alike. The image of God applies to each of us, regardless of our moral character, whether we do good or we do bad. Gorgeous celebrities and ugly-hearted gangsters, respectable scholars and down-and-out junkies, selfish billionaires and self-sacrificing sweatshop workers, oppressed, oppressors, sinners, saints, every individual, every human being, you, me, even those for whom God's image is caked in the dirt of sin and almost impossible to see. Meaning that each and every human being is made in the image of God. The image of God is something that cannot be taken from any human being. Every human being is infinitely precious, meaning that each person's worthy of the same dignity, respect, and opportunity, meaning that each person's worthy of the same love we owe to God. Fine print. Every single one. Next, thinking about how, as the minister, to address the issues of race that have rapidly surfaced in the past few weeks at recent events and openly expressed your helplessness, and I felt the same. I fear coming out of a place of defensiveness. I fear not doing justice to the depth of people, one group, political party, or ideology that I favor just because I favor it. Maybe most of all, I fear giving easy answers to extremely complex and difficult problems. So as a minister, as a pastor, as a spiritual leader, what can I say that hasn't already been said? And in fact, likely said better. All I can do, really, is bring us all back to basics. The basics found in the depth of our tradition and in the Word of God. Basic truths like the one in today's scripture, that each human being, regardless of race, regardless of tribe, regardless of status, identity, or moral character, is made in the image and likeness of God. Because what we need as individuals, as societies, as a world, is more than just a few chain policy. What we need is conversion. We need a fundamental transformation of our consciousness from the ground up. We need to have how we see ourselves and we see others completely refocused to see the image and likeness of God, not only in those who we love, God we meet in Jesus Christ, staring right back at us. This isn't the end of things, of course, but for us, this is where true change always begins. It begins here in Genesis. At the beginning of all things, it begins with what we were made, who we were created to be, and who we're loved by. It begins with the image and likeness of God. So may each of us not be conformed to this world and its ways of division, prejudice, and hatred, but instead, by God's grace, May each of us be transformed by the renewing of our minds, to see the image of God in each person, and to claim our identity as children of God and God's universal love as our own. Amen.
This day God gives me strength of heaven. Flashing at lightning, wind in its swiftness, deeps of the ocean, firmness of earth. This day God sends new strength to sustain me, right to uphold me, wisdom as guide. Your eyes are watchful, your ears are listening, your lips are speaking. Friend of my side, God's way is my way, God's shield is round me, God's first defends me. Saving from ill, angels of heaven, drive from me always all that would harm me. Stand by me still. Rising, I thank you, mighty and strong one, King of creation, giver of rest. Firmly confessing, threeness of persons, oneness of Godhead, Trinity. Please join me in affirming our faith in the words of the Ancient Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
God calls us to be a praying people. Let us join in prayer
offering our praise, thanksgiving, and intercessions to God. Today, for our prayer requests, we offer prayers of thanksgiving for Deborah and Clinton, for taking care of our church building, and for all of those who are serving the Sunshine Lunch Club. We offer prayers for Ernie Von Schilling for strength as he begins his treatment for cancer, and for Delia as she supports him through this process. We pray prayers of safety and easing of anxieties and fears for all those going back to work as the economy starts to reopen in phase two. Carolyn asks us to remember Steve Nice Warner, a friend in Maryland who is suffering with COVID. Although he is still on a ventilator, his condition is improving a little each day. So we ask for continued prayers. We ask for prayers for peace in the areas of civil unrest in the United States and around the world. So attention is drawn to the core issue with the hopes of true change and not overshadowed by even more violence. We offer prayers of guidance for civil leaders to ensure that the tragedy of George Floyd's death will truly inspire change that results in equality for all people, and hope that this generation of children growing up will not only read about discrimination, will only now read about discrimination in history books instead of experiencing or witnessing firsthand. Sylvia sends a prayer request for her son Patrick, who lives in Calgary and is unemployed, as he has a family of seven to support. We offer prayers for Margaret Wallace, who is in the hospital with pneumonia. Prayers for Frank, who is recovering from vascular surgery in Baltimore. From Hope, we offer thanksgiving for Hope's son and daughter-in-law, who have found new lodgings after losing all their belongings in a for repair of fractures to his arm. And thanksgiving for the presence of God in our faith community. We feel your prayers and know you are close by. We give thanks, O God, for our world, which you have made and renewed. In the power of Jesus' resurrection, make us wise and careful of your gifts as we live on earth. We pray that the love which passes ceaselessly between the Father and the Son and in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit may renew and deepen the life of each of us and draw us into your unending life. Into your hands, we entrust all that is of concern this day, sure that you hear our pleas, grateful that your will be done on earth as in heaven. We pray this in the name of the Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. As children turn to a mother who watches over them, let us turn to God with the prayer Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Now that we've offered up our lives and trusted, it's the time where we offer up our gifts of time, talent, and treasure for God's mission in the world. Giving the source back the due owed to God for God's mission and world. Truly, for those of you, the Sunshine Lunch Club to continues to distribute meals Monday through Friday, And so if you're able to give, we invite you to continue your generosity, either by using the text to give function, following the link, go to the church web. You can give by e-transfer to donations@stgeorgesunited.com. And again, if you're not able to, if you have an offering and you're not able to get it to the church, please contact the church office and we will send someone to your door to pick up. Again, we are truly enables us to continue to be the church together. So with that, Eve will be offering some meditative music as we offer our lives to God.
This beautiful song, Praise to God, is number 243 in our Voices United book. It is a melody that many of you may recognize. The words are beautifully put together to reflect what we have been thinking of all day today for the creation of the world and for God, three in one.
Thank you, Eve. Please join me in the offering prayer and consecrating our gifts to God's use. In the name and in the Spirit of Jesus, we give them with a ready mind, a willing spirit, spirit and a joyful heart. And we will conclude with our hymn. It's a song of praise to the Maker. This beautiful imagery in creation of God's Trinity at work.
It's a song of praise to the Maker. The thrush sings high in the tree. It's a song of praise to the Maker. The gray whale sings in the sea. And by the Spirit, you have thought, give joy a voice to the Holy Cross. And sing, sing, sing to the Maker. It's a call of life to the giver when waves and waterfalls roar. It's a call of life to the giver when high tides break on the shore. And by the Spirit, you and I can join our voice to the Holy Cross and sing, sing, sing to the Maker. It's a hymn of love to the Lord. The bumblebees hum along. It's a hymn of love to the lover. The summer breeze joins the song. And by the Spirit, you and I can join our voice to the Holy Cross and sing, sing, sing to the Maker. It's a chorus of all creation, it's sung by all living things. It's the chorus of all creation, a song the universe sings. And by the Spirit, you and I can join our voice to the Holy Cross and sing, sing, sing to the Maker too.
Go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return all people who are bearers of the image and likeness of God. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be yours this day and every single day. Amen.
Go forth with God, go to the world in joy, to serve God's people every day and hour. And serving Christ, our every gift employ, rejoicing in the Holy Spirit's power. Go forth in God, go to the world in joy. There's nowhere in the world that I would rather be than with you, my friends. And there's nothing in the world that I would rather see than your smiles again. For united we stand, divided we fall. And if our back should ever be against the wall, we'll be together, together, you and I. For united we stand, divided we fall. And if our back should ever be against the wall, we'll be together, together, you and I. If the world around you falls apart, my love, I'll still be right here. And if the going gets too hard along the way, you just call, I'll hear. For united we stand, divided we fall. And if our back should ever be against the wall, we'll be together, together, you and I. For united we stand, divided we fall. And if our back should ever be against the wall, we'll be together, together, you and I. For united we stand, divided we fall. And if our back should ever be against the wall, we'll be together, together, you and I.
Together, you and I. Amen.
Well, I won't keep everybody waiting, but that was a wonderful gift. Thank you, Heather and Gregor. Thank you so much for that song. Before we jump into the town hall, there's a few logistics, I suppose. If you do have a question, I think there's a tool that you can raise your hand and anybody jump in, or there's a Q&A option, or you can enter your question into the comment box. But we're just going to go over a general scope, and I just want to say we're so thankful for everyone who has come to worship every Sunday and has been with us, and the people who just, like, everyone who's just come and joined us online, because this has been such a strange time of adapting to a new life, a new way of doing things. And I feel really blessed to be your chair. If you don't know, I'm Kara Derma. I'm chair of the Board of Elders here at St. George's United Church. And today we just want to communicate, instead of avalanching you with a big letter saying this is what's happening. So we'll just take you through some of the steps, some of the things we are discerning over in the coming weeks, and where we're moving into the summer season. So yeah, we can move into the next slide if we want. So over the summer, we're gonna finish June, have regular summer service, but we will be having our joint worship services. So July 5th, it will be St. George's joint online worship, which we plan for now to do it live. And there will be some Comox United will be hosting online worship, Comox Valley Presbyterian, July 12th, 19th. And then we're back to regular worship online July 26th and through August. So that